this is astonishing. I mean, one of the footballers says he's actually going to go on a hunger strike. What's driving him to do that?
Well, I mean, pure blind desperation. I mean, when I spoke to Zahir Belounis, he told me that he hadn't been paid wages for 23 months. He had a contract. He told me he had a contract for 5 years with Al Jesh, which is the army football team of Qatar. Had a very successful first couple of seasons, but he fell out with somebody. His contract was ripped up, and when he complained about it in the court system, he was essentially, or he alleges, blackmailed into dropping the case. And if he didn't drop the case, he wouldn't be given an exit visa. And unfortunately, this is a case that is all too common for most migrant workers in Qatar. We're talking 1.2 million people there who are largely from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, working on very low wages, building these new shiny skyscrapers that you see. And the kafala system, this system of sponsorship, ties a worker to their employer. So if there are any disagreements, then there's a huge room, according to human rights groups, for exploitation and for these kind of stalemates to happen. So at the moment, this footballer who, you know, obviously originally signed a contract that was, you know, you'd say it was a far better contract than, say, a migrant worker who's working on a building site. You know, essentially, he's not been paid for 2 years. He's got two daughters. He's got his wife. But the worst thing is that even as a French citizen, as a guy who's French Algerian, but he holds a French passport, to be prevented from leaving a country because his exit visa can't be given to him, it sounds astonishing in the 21st century.
What are human rights groups saying about this? Could it be that this will shed light on a larger problem and put pressure on the government?
Well, there's been some huge interest from human rights groups, especially Human Rights Watch and the International Trade Union Confederation, who have been in a dialogue with the Qatari 2022 Supreme Committee, who are kind of in charge of the preparations for the World Cup, and with FIFA, who's global soccer's governing body. And they've been in discussions, but interestingly, the ITUC has pulled out of those discussions, saying that nothing has changed over the past 2 years, that there's been a workers' charter, but there's been very little on-the-ground improvement in the conditions of workers who live there. And Human Rights Watch have been absolutely damning of the conditions, not just in Qatar, you have to remember. This is across the Gulf region. The kafala system exists in the UAE and in Saudi Arabia as well. And in a way, because Qatar has won this bid to win the World Cup, there is more focus on them and there is a more of a drive for reform. So, you know, for the Qataris, they say we're reforming, this is a step-by-step process. But for Human Rights Watch, you know, they're saying we're going to keep a look at the situation, whereas the ITUC are saying this is time to really stop Qatar having the World Cup, reopen the vote. They've proven after the past 2 years that they are not ready for it and that reforms really are only skin deep and not really making a difference on the ground. Unbelievably, we've approached the Ministry of Labour, we've approached the Qatari FA, the Football Association, also the Qatar Stars League. And actually what came back wasn't, you know, we're taking a look at this case. We're going to open a case for defamation against one of the players for making these accusations to the international press. So it's very difficult to take... You know, on the one hand, some bodies within Qatar are saying, yes, we know there's a problem. We need to change this. But this is obviously a gradual process of change. With the fact that the football club and the football association involved, then essentially would like to punish the player for making this known to the wider world. So actually very little has come back from the Qataris on this.